warm water worship. And for that period of time, I heard God teach me how we ought to worship. What is expected of us when we come into His house? And I went and I looked at the tabernacle, the Old Testament. And as you know, you can see, you can come to the gate and take your Baptist church and take your church, but you're not in church. And I looked at it, and the outer court of the tabernacle, they spent a lot of time getting themselves ready to go in, cleansing, doing all the preparation. But when I looked at it also, it was at that time when it's only the priest alone who go into the inner court. And for us today, it's not like that. And I said to myself that we come at times, and for some of us, we do preaching in a court. And the Lord later on heart brought me, us being in the outer court, is as if I get here every Sunday, stand here, and look at my wife and say, Leon, you're lovely. You're so kind to me. You've been there for me. You protect, you provide, you do all of it. But yet, through the years, we have not been any intimacy. And God, He wants us to come in. He wants us to reason with Him. If you want to worship Him, you must worship in spirit and in truth. You need, I need to get in here, the inner court. How do you know when you get in here? When you get in here, there's one audience, and that's Jesus Christ. And being in there, it does not matter what type of music Omar is playing. It does not matter what pastor preach. It does not matter what the worship leader is wearing. You know, and I found myself, as I examine myself, I have to go to the Lord and confess. But there are times that I've lived here and I've said, you know, the service day nights. If you're in there, in His presence, there's fullness of joy. And the Lord wants you to be that you were in there. You were just in the outer courts. Just praising. And that is why the unsaved cannot worship. You need to stay in the outer courts. But when you get in there, He will counsel you. He will comfort you. He will strengthen you. And what I found out is that pastor cannot worship for me. Dion cannot worship for me. We can praise together. We can sing together. But we have to go in individually. And as I thought about everything, I said, long time to that, in there, there is no social distance. So I have to worry that I'm going to go for pastor and I'm going to go for colleague here. No, no. And it was so wonderful. So here, you know that there's one audience. Two, when you get in there, is a sense of overwhelming gratitude for what He has done for you. When you're in there, tears are crying. You're not afraid to get down. You're not afraid. Sometimes you get in here. Words cannot explain how you feel. You have to say thank you. You cannot you cannot comprehend the whole of God. So great that we love you. And when I realized and looked at it, I also learned that when you get in here, you never been seen. I remember the disciples on the road of Emmaus. He said, "In your heart burned within us as he talked with us, as he moved the word for us." So, I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, thanks the Lord that, Lord, today I want you to move within here. A song, the Holy Spirit can get you in here. A testimony, also can get you in here. Preaching word can get you in here. And the Lord said something to me, the Holy Spirit said something, and it burdened so much. And I have to question, why is it that we as Christians aren't being effective, are being powerful? Why is it? I mean, when I look around the COVID, I know so many people are Christians who are fearful. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Why is it? And he said something to me that he brought tears to my eyes. And I'm going to say to you, the Lord said to me, the Holy Spirit said, you know, perhaps some of you that do not have my spirit, quite all the worship God. You have to be spirit to spirit. When you get in here, you will have to be saved. God has not as your heart towards a Christian, and you have asked him to come in. Have you acknowledged that he's our Lord and Savior? But we need to know you. And when we let him come in, we're not going to just act on him, but we need to suck with him. And that's what he said in Revelation. I'm not. So this morning, my name, and you should hear this out, that you want him to get to here. You want him to talk to you. You want him to counsel you. When you leave here, no matter what passes, no matter what's been done, I know that I have been with you. And you will leave here rejoicing. And I have to confess, I am not perfect, I have to confess God, that there's so many times I went to say, what? Church wasn't this. And God, you weren't in there. You weren't in there. Some people, the choir sing, oh, they're not singing my song, that's not my song, forget, and I like that song. You see, we have to know we're going to worship God. We have to sing praise and worship. And the Lord said to me, Mr. President, we need to do a lot of praising. But the words, my people are not caring for me because he needs us to get in there. And this morning, I want you to take time off. I ask the Lord, the Holy Spirit, to move you in that place. For years, I've been a Christian. You have been a Christian. And for some, we have not felt the moving of the Lord and of our life in our lives. You're just going through emotion. You're just doing things out of tradition. And I believe from the bottom of my heart that we are not God in here. We need as a good thing.
a good, good father. And if you are a beneficiary of His goodness, of His mercy, I think as a people, we need to be shouting and singing out more. And we need to be excited. He has protected us through this time. He has been there for us. He has never left us. And as a people come and go and say, He's a good Father, He has been good to us, oh, Heavenly Father. The next word's been, we make, You are here, moving in our midst. And we come to worship You. Worship You. Let us sing, God's people, let us sing.
I worship You.
What a beautiful name it is. Jesus. And the name of Jesus.
Happy Father's Day to all those fathers among us. And my brother asked me to say Happy Grandfather's Day. I don't know why. Grandfathers, don't worry, time will come. If you are grandfathers among us, Happy Grandfather's Day. There might be a little confusion regarding what I'm supposed to be doing here. Somebody said it's a testimony. My understanding of what I was supposed to be doing was to give you a brief, with the emphasis on brief, talk on fatherhood, of course with a personal perspective. So, here goes. Many of you will know that I'm commonly associated with the Marriage Fellowship arm of this church, and I'm often heard to say that marriage is an institution, an office created by God that offers certain avenues, particular avenues of worship, that we should conduct the marriage as an act of worship. Similarly, I think that fatherhood is an institution, an office created by God. After all, God created fathers. An institution and an office created by God that offers particular avenues of worship. Now, like marriage, fatherhood is entered into by a choice. Yes, a choice, an actual conscious decision. There are some who take this decision with little or no thoughts. Some might say many who take this decision with little or no thoughts. And there are others who think about it. But like all decisions, fatherhood carries consequences. There are consequences to the decision to become a father, whether you thought about it, no, or whether you didn't. And to be honest, many of the consequences of fatherhood, the weight of this burden didn't really catch on to me until after I became a father. What are some of these consequences? I think in any society, anywhere in the world, regardless of religion, it is a cultural norm that fathers have a duty, and I say a duty, which means that there's an obligation attached to it, have a duty of care, protection, and to raise their children. Raising their children means to mold, to inculcate values and character that make your children good human beings. Now, this is a huge burden. Don't, big burden, don't pray. Yeah, put you on the spot. This is a huge burden. You have a responsibility for another human being to rear them in a manner where they will exhibit good character traits. Now, in order to show good character traits, you really have to live it. You have to demonstrate it. You have to be exemplary in demonstrating this, because human beings primarily learn by imitation, okay? They act out what they see. So a father who cares about the character of his children really has to demonstrate it in his life. Okay, but what about the father? Where does the father learn these traits, these good character and moral traits that he wants to his children to imitate? If you take out your smartphone and you do a Google search on qualities of a good father, you will see a whole list of links, as long as I am. Many of them by noted psychologists with a whole bunch of letters after their name. But here's the thing. There is no university that offers a degree in character. None. There is no university that offers letters after your name in morality. So where does the father then find this example of character and morality for him to demonstrate in his life for his children then to follow? Is a father left in the dark? Jesus, in recording, I think he's in John chapter 8 verse 12, made some phrase sticks in your mind and you can't get it out of your head. you know, no matter what you're doing. That's been my case the last few days. There's a particular phrase that comes from a psalm that was stuck in my head. This morning when I'm making breakfast and bacon fat burned me, that's the phrase that came to my head. When I was watching the early news and I turned off the TV, that phrase came to my head. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the Father, that's my insertion. Blessed is the Father that trusteth in me. And if we as fathers take that on, you can't go wrong. You really can't go wrong. Just go along and enjoy the life and enjoy your children. Thank you.
At this time, we'd ask Brother Green to come and it's been a special.
Good morning, church. God is good all the time. Before I sing this song, which I really love, I can recall and say thanks to God Almighty for His care and His mercies around me. And speaking of Father, I grew up with my mom, and I did scared of my father. I did it really rough. And the second thing I scared of from a youth growing is the lightning, when the lightning cut, chip. One day at my home, I turned the ball lick, and believe you me, I was really tremble and nervous. And I said to, in that moment, I said to God, I have an earthly father, and I'm afraid of him. And you are my heavenly father, and you make me. And I should not be fear of you when you cut your lightning. So God, I'm begging you, I'm asking you, to help me that when you flash that lightning, I'll be in my quiet spirit. And would you believe that, brothers and sisters? God answered my prayer. No, a day is when the lightning cut, I just keep still. There's a passage in the Bible that says, when the Lord is in His holy temple, let all earth keep silent before Him. And that's why I know I have a heavenly Father who cares for me, and not for me only, but for all of us who we trust in Him. And as I sing this song is a prayer to God, to our Heavenly Father, and to all of us that we apply the word of this song and a prayer to our heart. Father, give me strength to do what I must do. Father, give me courage to say what I must say. Let thy spirit move me. I'm nothing on my own. Father, stand by me. I cannot stand alone. In Jesus' name I pray. Father, open up my eyes to your wonders all around. Father, let me see the beauty of this day. Fill my heart with love for my fellow man. If I'm tempted, Father, stay my hand. In Jesus' name I pray. Father, help me through the troubled day that lies ahead. Let your light shine before me, that I may find my way. Lest me stumble, Father, or fall beneath my load. Father, stand by me. I cannot stand alone. In Jesus' name I pray. Let my anger be my guard, nor fear be my master. Father, let my enmity follow me in any way. Father, search my soul. Take away my fears and doubt. Father, sanctify me. Father, cast it out. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank you.
tells his father how he really feels. A handshake or a pat on the back is all that he reveals. I'd like to right that wrong. Here in
Happy Father's Day to all dads, and may the Lord bless you!
Thank you for shaping my life. Thank you for teaching me all you can. You are no ordinary man. No, no, no. You make me everything I am. Thank you for taking the time. Thank you for showing me the way. And thank you for being there when I need you. Thank you for every single day. Now I've been blessed with a son of my own. Got my own bedtime stories to tell. If I can raise him.
Happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. We want you to know that we honor you, respect you, because you have been good fathers. So Happy Father's Day and enough respect.
Thank you for your guiding hand. Thank you for making my dreams come true. You're an extraordinary man, and I hope you're as proud of me as I am proud of you. For giving me life. Thank you for showing me good from bad. I guess I'm only really trying to say thank you for being my dad. Even though the years drift away, I never took the time just to say I love you, and I always have. And thank you for being my dad. Thank you for being my dad.
I, daddy.
You at your worst, he'll do anything. A father, he shows you what love is. Saw your dreams before you did. He'll give everything like your heavenly father. I see God in my father's eyes. Like the Father, in the way He loves you. A Father's like the Father when it
is no superhero like a father. The fathers and the heroes that we would always want to look up to. To all our heroes and role models in wellness, I would like to wish you guys a happy Father's Day. Thank you for being there for our families and for us. And we are grateful for you guys. We love you with all our hearts.
This morning's reading is taken from Psalms 139, reading from verse 1 through to 20. Response: here begins. O Lord, thou hast searched me and know me. Thou compassest my path and my laying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. Whither shall I go from thy spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I take up the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, if I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light upon me, about me. For thou hast possessed my reins, as thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. My substance was not hid from thee, when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God! How great is the sum of them! Surely thou wilt slay the wicked, O God. Depart from me, therefore, ye bloody men. Do not I hate them, O Lord, that hate thee? And am not I grieved with thee, those who raise up against thee? Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my thoughts. 24 times. Wicked in me. Everlasting. Hearing the reading of God's holy word, honored by saying, thanks be to God.
He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the little tiny baby in his hands. He's got a little tiny baby in his hands. He's got a little tiny baby In his hands he's got the new world. In his hands he's got you and me, brother. In his hands he's got you and me, brother. In his hands he's got you and me, brother. In his hands he's got the whole world. In his hands he's got you and me, sister. In his hands he's got you and me, sister. In his hands he's got you and me, sister. In his hands he's got the whole world. In his hands he's got every father here. In his hands he's got every father here. In his hands he's got every father here. In his hands he's got the whole world. In his hands he's got the whole world. In his hands he's got the whole wide world. In his hands he's got the whole 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 wide world. In his hands he's got the whole 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 world.
For today, let us pray. Lord, we come before you. Pray that you will just bless the time as we look into your word now. We thank you again for the fathers. We thank you for the commitment that they have made to be good fathers to your children. We pray that they'll feel special, that they'll feel loved and appreciated. And Lord, we thank you, God, for being our Heavenly Father, because without you, these men could not be good fathers. Without a model, without a standard, we would have nothing to look to. And we thank you, God, for being our Heavenly Father. Pray, dear God, that you will just bless the time around your word now, that it will be of benefit and inspiration to our fathers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, the day is far spent for some of you fathers. I want you to note that it's not that Pastor Madden preached long today. It's almost 12:30, all right? So when you see 1 o'clock come and you wonder why I may not finish it, I got up here later today. All right, nevertheless, indeed. Let me just say this before I forget. I know that some of you might, fathers, might be doing something this afternoon or this evening. Children or your wives, spouses, maybe taking you out. But if you're not doing anything, I just wanted to remind you that church is still keeping you here. Church is still keeping at 7 p.m. and we're back to the normal time, being an extended curfew that starts at 10. So we run from 7 to 8:30. But we could let you out a little earlier today, being Father's Day. But here's why I'm promoting this, that if you're not doing anything, not just the fathers, but anybody at all, if you're not, you know, having a special thing for your father this evening, come out to church, because based on what I'm going to look at now, I'm going to be looking at the good father and, you know, three traits that a good father should have. But this evening, I want us to discuss this a little. We're not going to look at 2 Peter. We're taking a break and looking at this evening. So I'm asking to come out. What am I going to look at? I want us to look at this idea this evening as, if you're a good father, if you're a godly father, does that guarantee that your children will follow suit? Does it guarantee that your children will be godly children? We want to look at that this evening. So come on out and let's discuss that. But that's this evening. What's happening right now? We want to look at the good father, as is mentioned, and I want to look at some examples in Scripture. I'm going to give you the 3 points, and I want you to understand that they are by no means the only traits that make a good father. I'm going to tell you what's not in it. We already know that a good father should provide for his household, right? So that's not in it. You know that already. I'm not going to give you the obvious. All right? We know that a good father should provide for his household. And we also know that a good father should be the protector of his household. I'm not going to talk about those two things either. That's given and known. And can I just put it this way? Many men, many fathers actually measure themselves against those two known ones. I am protecting and I'm providing. What more you want? And I've heard men say that to their spouses and sometimes even to their children. You know, can I just put it this way? Let me first salute you for being a protector. Let me salute you for being a provider. But there is still more to it. So the measurement, the standard is going to increase today. Here are three more things. That if you're going to call yourself a good father, I believe these three things must be in it. Not just protector and provider. Here are the three things. The good father should have a positive influence on his children. The good father should have a positive influence on his children. Secondly, the good father should give good guidance to his children. The good father should give good guidance to his children. And thirdly, the good father should nurture and care for his children. So we're going to look at that. And by God's grace, fathers, listen up. Some of you already are practicing this, all of these things. You are super dads. But if some of you are honest, maybe they didn't come today, or maybe you did. If you're being honest with yourself, if you were to evaluate yourself as a father, have you been doing these things? I'm here to both encourage you and to also ask you to pull up your socks as a father, because can I put it this way? If you have not been meeting the standards as the father anywhere too, whether Mother's Day and otherwise, can I put it this way? It is difficult for people to appreciate you when you don't meet the standards. Oh, you didn't get that. What if there are persons who are not good fathers? You know what will happen? Even if you get a gift on Father's Day, you get a happy Father's Day, you know? Can I put it this way? It's like almost forced, you know? Can I put it, sometimes it's fake as well. I'm just putting it this way. Come on, don't look at me like that. You know how the thing set. This person might not deserve it, but because it's Father's Day. This person might not deserve it, but because it's Mother's Day. I'm going to have to say something now, it's going to look bad. My point is this. Make sure that you are good fathers so that when your children or your spouse, your partner comes to you to honor you, it will not have to be forced or fake. It will be out of that glad and appreciative heart that you, Dad, you have earned this. You are a good father. Amen? Amen. So big up to you who have been doing this. Let's go back to the first one. The good father should have a positive influence on his children. And many of us here are Christian men, and you are Christian fathers. And I would dare say, if you want to change that word from positive to spiritual, because it's a Christian situation, you should have a spiritual influence on your children. But I'm speaking of positive because it could include spiritual and otherwise as well. Let's look at three examples under this point. We're going to look at Abraham, Jacob, and Joshua, AJJ. Now listen, none of them have been perfect fathers. None of them have been perfect men. But they were still good men. They've made their mistakes, but they were still good men and actually still good father. And the reason why I'm starting with Abraham, because the accolades came from God. The commendations actually came from God. And I say something to you. When God is the one that is commenting about you, you can trust that the information is valid. You can trust that the information is true and it is just. So here is a situation. Turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 18. As you turn there, I'm only going to read one verse. But as you turn to Genesis chapter 18, just giving you a background of what you're turning to, this is the passage where the three men, alias angels, most people think it's angels, visited Abraham, and they were coming to bear the news to Abraham that his old wife and him, his as an old man, will be conceiving a son. They'll be having a child. And, you know, both of them found that a little difficult to accept. So that's the context under which it was said. And when it was said and Sarah was eavesdropping and heard, she laughed. And so the angel said something, and then it is the idea through God himself. And so we're going to just jump at verse 18. In fact, let's start from verse 17. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. All right? Verse 19, no. For I know him, that he, this is God speaking about Abraham, you know. This is not anybody else, you know. All right? For I know him that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he had spoken of him. God says, I know Abraham. I can vouch for him. What did he say about him in verse 19? That he will command his children. That Abraham is in control of his house. What kind of influence do you have over your children? That could God actually say this about you? I know so and so, remove Abraham and put the blank there and put your name there. I know you, and I know that you have control over your children. I know that you command them. It is not the idea of dominating and dictating like you're Caesar or like you are, you know, Hitler. No, but it's the idea that you rule them with love, you lead them with love, but that you also place the firm hand when necessary. It is not an idea of a father who is wishy-washy and weaky-weaky. God says, I know Abraham, and he will command his children, and then watch this, and his household after him. Meaning, anyone else, any generation that follows after him, that comes down the road, he is going to make sure he passes on the values. That's what God is saying about Abraham. And they, watch this, shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he had spoken of him. A good father should have a positive influence on his children, a spiritual influence, a good influence. It is a moral influence. A good father should make sure that they're teaching and leading their children in a way, or your child, if it's one child you have. It doesn't matter, one or too many. It doesn't matter. Whatever you have, if you have your whole lot of football field, you have been entrusted with this responsibility of giving them that positive influence. But how do you have a positive influence? You must, as Deacon Everard Proud says, you must lead by example. It is interesting that there are some fathers who will say to their children, don't do this, don't do this, behave yourself. And some of the fathers are not behaving themselves. So you have to lead by example. As they said, they imitate what they're seeing. So listen, make sure that you are modeling that, fathers, so that you will have an influence over your children and on your children. The idea of having an influence on them, you know, it is not just what you say. I want you to get that. It's what you do. It's who you are. If you are going to influence them, it means that they're watching you for that impact. And so I want to encourage you men, you fathers, to influence your children in a positive way. Abraham did so. And God could actually vote for him. And the commentary about him was good. You're still in Genesis, so turn to Genesis chapter 35. We will look briefly at Jacob. Now, Jacob was being called by God to go somewhere else. And I want you to note what Jacob did. We're just going to read verses 1 to 4. Look at what Jacob did. And to his family's household. And God said unto Jacob, Genesis 35 verse 1, and God said unto Jacob, arise, go up to Bethel, and live there, dwell there. I'm changing your location. Go and live there. All right, I'll read the verse before I comment anymore. And make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother. Now I want you to, before you look at verses 2, 3, and 4, I want you to understand something. This is one of the most debated in modern day families. What am I talking about? The idea that if God calls the man of the house, if God calls the father of the house, what about the family? Are they called to go too? Can I put it this way? Even if God calls the man to do a specific task, the father, the man, the husband, the patriarch, even if God calls the man to do a specific task that you, the family, are not supposed to fulfill, understand that you are supposed to be going along with the man of the house. Whoa. Yes. This is a geographical relocation. And so Jacob took charge of his house, and this is what he did. Verse 2. Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him. And so this could be more than just blood relatives, you know. This could be the idea of the whole servants, everybody that's with him. The whole household and to all that were with him. Anybody that's following Jacob, that's being a part of the household, servants and otherwise, family members, spouse, children, put away the strange gods that are among you and be clean. And change your garments. A good father should have a positive influence over their family, over their children, and over their family, by the way. Here he's saying, God has called us to go. It's not me alone. We're going to be going. But before we go, he says to them, put away the strange gods that are among you. He knew that there was stuff going on with his family. He knew that there was stuff going on in his household. And, you know, maybe you might have been saying, but why never deal with it before? All right, we're humans. People are human. But he's dealing with it now. And he says, if we're going to move to where God has called us to, listen, we have to shake up our folly ground. We have to get to the place that we're not going over there. We're not going to bring the drama with us. I like that. We're not going to bring the same drama with us. We're going to leave that behind. We're not going to bring the immoral lifestyle. We're not going to bring the dirty stuff. We're going to leave that behind. He's taking charge of his family, and he says, if you're going to come with me, and you will, you better put away those strange gods that are among you and be clean and change your garments. The idea of changing your garments was really a literal term, but it was figurative. It was symbolic. Some of you would have known this already, that the idea of changing your outer garment was a symbol of the inner change that you're making. So it is the idea that they literally did change their garments outside as a symbol that we are going to make a decision on the inside to recommit, to clean up, take off the dirty clothes and put on new clean clothes. And the same thing must be happening in their heart. So he's dealing with that. With his family. Then he says in verse 3, and let us arise and go up to Bethel. Notice the talk, you know, that's why I say, can I just put it this way? I'm going to talk everything today, you know. Some of you may not come back for Father's Day or otherwise, so I want to talk everything today. Just bear with me. Notice the term us, the word us. Sometimes there is a split and a divide in the family. Sometimes it might be the man talking like him just talking for himself. Sometimes it may be the wife. Sometimes it may be the children. But notice there was no divisiveness in his talk. It's us. We're a team here. We're a family. Let us arise and go up to Bethel. And I will make there an altar unto God. So the man taking charge, you know, he's doing the spiritual thing. I will make. No, he's the priest. And I'm certain everyone knows that the man is the appointed priest in the house. Amen? A little louder. Amen? Amen? All right. So, let us arise and go, and I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. And what happened? Did they disobey? No. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears. And Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem. I find this, a number of things happening in verse 4 here. First of all, I find humility, humbleness. They humble themselves, and then I find submission. Then I find obedience. You know, I want you to understand, fathers, lead your children, lead your family lovingly for them to be willing to follow you. Amen? Oh, it's low, man. Come on. You're not sleeping on me? Lead them lovingly. Have a positive influence on them so that when you speak, your family will be ready to follow you. And did you notice who they gave all of the representative of strange gods to? They said man of the house. So they gave unto Jacob. So this includes everybody, children, wife, servants. They brought all the strange gods which were in their hand and all their earrings which were in their ears. Come on, people, don't go there. Somebody saying, then what's wrong with the earring? You see, it's not the thing that was wrong with the earring, but it's what the earring represented. Remember, it is Jacob that had told them in verse 2, put away the strange gods. These, and if you check the culture of what was going on, you see, his family was distracted and diverted. His family, they were worshiping and serving other gods, and these emblems like the earring and whatever else they brought to him, all of these things that they brought to him, they might not have been wrong in and of themselves, but they were representing that strange god, the idolatry. And you see, sometimes if we are engaged in idolatry, idolatry is anything you put before God. If you are going to sometimes tear yourself away from those things in order to serve God, sometimes you're going to have to put them away altogether and say, I'm done with this. But men, fathers, you have to lead by example. It is not said here, but it could be possible that even Jacob himself, if there was something he needed to give up, he would have put it in too. And so, what is your idol, man? Men, what is your idol, father? Is there something you need to put away as well? Can I just put it this way? Some of your spouses, some of the female spouses, men, some of your children are kind of waiting on you, you know, to lead by example. You cannot be the father who says, do this, even if I don't do it. You lead by example and you do this first and you say, children, I want you to see what your dad is doing today. I'm humbling myself before and I'm telling you sorry for turning to strange gods as well. I'm humbling myself before and I'm telling you sorry for not being the father that I used to, I should be. And then by example, you take that step and then watch them follow. Amen? Oh, Lord. Amen? Amen. 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 So, a good father should have a positive influence on his children, and that positive influence should be spiritual, all right? And notice what Jacob did. He hid them under the oak which was by Shechem, and I did a little study on the oak situation, and it was, what, it's the idea of oak trees had deep roots, and the idea is that he may have just dug it so deep and put it under this root that is deep that people, nobody would be able to come back. If they're going to find it, they're going to have to dig real deep to find it. So it was symbolic to the idea of, I'm putting these things away so that we never return to them again. I said three, so let's go on to the third one, Joshua. A positive influence on your children. We looked at Abraham, we looked at Jacob, and we looked at Joshua. Now, turn to Joshua chapter 24, the last chapter in Joshua. Joshua chapter 24. This is a famous verse. And I want you to, yeah, I'm going to do something different. I just felt led to do this, and I think this is going to be great if the fathers participate. I want every father in this house right now to read with me Joshua 24 and verse 15. Joshua 24 and verse 15. Every father, please read verse 15 with me after three. One, two, three. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I know you know this verse very well. And I know it has been preached on by me and so many other people. I know you've seen the devotionals. But you know, sometimes when you look at a verse again, something afresh came to me. Something fresh came to me. And I said to myself, I want to share this with our men. Men, fathers, you just read it. And then by extension, myself, if I'm not a biological father, but man, if you're a leader, I want you to understand something, you know. Brother Proud nailed everything on the head with that testimony slash talk. We have a great responsibility. And it's also a great privilege. Let me ask you a question. Here's what I'm getting to. Fathers, can you talk on the behalf of your house like this? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. When you see me take off my glasses, you know, serious things, you know. I don't know your business, men. But I'm going to step out on a limb and say this. Not every man can say this. And if some fathers say this, for certainty, they don't mean it, or they feel like a hypocrite. This is a, come on people, work with me. Men, work with me. You're talking on behalf of your families, and you're saying, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. This speaks of confidence in what your family is doing, confidence in whom your family is serving, for you to talk about that, you know. And I want to use the word guardedly. It also speaks of control of your household. And we're not talking about the dictatorship control. Men, can you honestly, can every man, every father in this building say, as for me and my wife and kids, my wife and children, or my wife and child, we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua could have just talked for himself, you know. Because that would have been the safer route to go. As for myself, me don't know about them, but me will serve the Lord. For him to say that, and that becomes Bible, it means that Joshua had confidence in whom his family served and control over his family. Some of you will know me at about, you know. Why, if he said that, me don't know how me don't know how, all right, me got tired of things them. I don't know. All right. I'll be loving, you know. Some of you men who are not having control over your house and are not having confidence in your household may be saying, boy, pastor, I chew your talk, but me can't even say it. Make she hear. No, say go, sorry, no, for some of you know. Me can't even say it. Make she hear, because she run the show. Some of you have given your woman, spouse, eh? We have to make sure somebody put all that out there. Yeah, your wife. Too much power. Too much authority. When the authority was given to the man. Women, you know this as well. And so, take back your authority if it has been stolen or robbed from you. So that if you as a godly man say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Wife, you say, yes, dear. Children say, yes, daddy. Some of you are struggling with it, and you know. Pastor, may I read in your face? Pastor, actually, you know the woman who may have. She's a struggle. It takes a godly man to rule his household well. And I'm not saying that it is easy. That's why I said, come back tonight, make us see if there's a guarantee that everybody will work well if you rule well. But by God's grace, you must start with being the example so that you can say, I am a father, a Christian father who takes my children, my family, you know, the whole work, I take them to church with me. We're talking about Christian men now. Let's put aside the unsaved man for a moment. We're talking about Christian men. Lord, I hope I'm not digging up too much antsiness. I want to come off of the point and I can't come off of it. Because and know that there are struggles going on in the household. Nobody have to tell me now, but the devil has always been attacking the head, which is the man. And some men have been marginalized. Some fathers have been marginalized. And Christian men have been marginalized. And can I put it this way? I'm going both sides. Sometimes some women have put them in the margins, while some men have remained in the margins. Women, pull them out, bring them out, and make them be the head. Men, come out of the margin and stand up and be a man. If I dare say this, I am going to say it. That if you decide to lead your wife and children in a loving way, the chances are very likely that they will follow you in a submissive way. You notice the word loving? And I said the chances are. Because there are some of your women who are saying, Pastor, talk to them because a long time I never even want to just beat up my chest pan him, son, but that you don't know in our lead. By the way, as a counselor, I've heard that term. In our lead. Over the years, I have heard that. And I'm saying, men, it's time. It is time to take that stand. Be the God man. Be the good man. Be the good father and lead your family so that you can speak on their behalf. If you dare speak on some of them behalf, they will say, which house? Oh, go with you. And not just from your spouse, but even from some children. Go with daddy. Are you not treat me well? Let me move on. You should have a positive influence on your children. Secondly, you should give good guidance to your children. A good father, the good father gives good guidance to his children. And when I say good, I would also say godly, eh? Good and godly guidance to the children. Go to 1 Kings chapter 2. As you go there, this is a story of David charging his son Solomon. This is a story where David was going to be dying soon. He's getting old. And he wanted to leave some choice words of advice and counsel to his son Solomon. And so 2 Kings chapter 2 verses 1 to 4 says it like this. Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die. And he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth. I'm going to be dying soon. I'm going to be buried one of these days. Be thou strong, therefore, and show thyself a man. We have a part there, men. Don't be in a hurry to leave. Don't be in a hurry to leave for your father's day dinner. Tarry with me a while and get this. Get all of this, men. One of the things you need to do for your children, whether it be a female or a male, you need to teach them good values and you need to guide them in the right way. Here is what he was talking to the male here, and he says, be strong. Listen, you have to teach your daughters to be strong. You have to teach your sons to be strong. This is not just about a male thing here. You have to teach your children courage. You have to guide them. This is a rough world, isn't it true? It's a tough world, isn't it true? Disappointments are going to come. Let us not be the kind of parents or spiritual parents who just shield and shelter our children from the real world so that when something bad happens, they don't know how to deal with it. Be the kind of father who will say, listen, my daughter, tell the things them. yes, I'm going to talk this thing. Some of your fathers may have been a little wild back then. And I know this might be hard for you to even share with your children, but it depends on what age, PG, 15, 16, whatever. You know, sometimes it is good to sit down with your daughter, if you have one, and to say, daughter, me also out there and me also wild. So may I tell you, be careful of some of these men because not all of them have your well-being in mind. Talk to her and say, listen, I was one of them out there chasing skirt tails. You understand? And she would have said, you, daddy? Yeah. But me wise up, me settle now. I'm saying to, just like all your daddy used to do that, and I hope you'll be talking as he used to and not still do that. But used to do that. Understand that there are some young men out there who are after. Talk to them. You see, you must not grow your children in a bubble. Don't grow your daughters in a bubble. Make them understand that there are real predators out there. Sit down and talk to them as early as them understand and demonstrating certain tendencies for the opposite sex. Sit down and talk with them. Let them hear it from daddy. And if you have a son or sons, talk to your son them. Teach them good values and tell them nothing scam, and don't ever try to push down somebody to get what you want. Teach them the values. Who else to do it but you? And so he's preparing his son, because after David was preparing his son Solomon, because he knew that after he died, anything is possible. So he said, be strong. And then he says, and show thyself a man. No, may I forget personal with that one here. If you have your son, fathers, if you have your son, teach them how to be a man. Teach them how to be a real man, a godly man. Boy, I may have to touch up everything today, no? Oh, Lord. Oh, Spirit says it. So here it goes. In this growing world of homosexuality and effeminatism, teach them how to be a real man, what a real man looks like. Because you must listen, the homos are out there trying to grab them, you know. You know, understand? And literally too, you know. You must think a joke thing this. Literally, as well as symbolically, trying to entice them. Teach them how to be a real man. And I want to go this part. If your son is not a homo, praise the Lord. Why did I say it that way? You need to understand that there's another sin that is out there called effeminate. You know, understand me? Some of me put it this way. Sometimes some fathers only glad so them son are not homo. They're not a homosexual. But you listen, if your son effeminate, in other words, me just want to spell it out now. If your son act like girl, it's no good either. So don't drop the standard and say, well, at least him a no homo, him only act like girl. Him not fi act like girl. You understand me? We're not talking. Show thyself a man. If you see your son a divert and a wear and a walk and a work somewhere and a move and a talk and a flash somewhere, sit down, talk him out, pray it out, show yourself a man. Say, son, this is not how men behave. This is not how men talk. This is not how men walk. A serious thing, you know? Effeminatism is mentioned in the Bible in Corinthians as a sin. It's not just homosexuality. You have to guard them from that. Because, can I tell you, there's a shade. There's a difference. Some men might not be homosexual, but they're effeminate. And then sometimes effeminate men become homosexuals. You want to get that one straight. Not every man that's effeminate is a homosexual. But some effeminate men become homosexuals. You need to get this straight. None of them are acceptable unto God. You understand me now? So teach your children. Give good guidance to them. And some of you men, sometimes all the guidance you give and you see them depart, and them turn transvestite and trans this and trans that. Sometimes you have to go transport them to the throne of God, because them now hear your guidance. Honestly, sometimes it's bigger than your guidance. Am I saying something? And sometimes you have to go say, son, come here, we'll go to the altar, and you pray. And you keep praying. Day after day, you keep praying, and you pray and say, Lord, help me. You see my desire. I don't want my son behave that way. I don't want my daughter behave that way. Because I don't touch upon the daughter them yet either. Because I don't know. Things say, you're right if you start act like man. Girls, if you start act like man, you're not right. It's not right either. So fathers are going to have to give guidance. And when that guidance is happening, you're going to have to pray for the right words to say and pray and say, Lord, help me. In fact, Lord, I love it when God does that Holy Spirit work on our heart so that you don't have so much to do. But remember, they are also listening out for you to say something. So make sure you give good guidance. I want to move on. I promise that you'll be out of here by 3 o'clock. Let's move on. I am just joking. When I wake up. But we have to talk to the fathers them today, not you? So we'll soon get to the dinner, man. Don't worry. Your children and your wife soon get to the dinner, man. Just wait. Verse 3. And keep the charge of the Lord thy God. So he's talking to his son. He says, listen, be strong, be a man, and keep the charge of the Lord. Keep the commandments, keep whatever, the testimonies, keep the charge of the Lord thy God to walk in his ways. He's challenging his son, he's charging his son to keep his statutes and his commandments and his judgments and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest, and whithersoever thou turnest thyself, that the Lord may continue his word, which he spake concerning me, David, saying, if thy children take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, God, a man on the throne of Israel. He is saying to his son that, listen, there's more at stake here than even you, Solomon, than even your life and your future. He's saying, a whole generation ahead is at stake. And my reputation in the back end is at stake here. God charged me to charge you. And if you don't walk in the way, the succession will not go on. So in order for the succession of godly heritage to be passed on, the throne to be passed on, Solomon, you must walk in the way. But David was holding himself responsible to make sure that he instilled in him that kind of guidance and charge him, because he took the responsibility seriously. Men, it is indeed a privilege. But with great privilege comes great responsibility. And it is up to you to make sure that you are giving good guidance to your children. Now, I'm going to move on to the third one, because in my estimation over the years as a pastor, and I was a counselor, by the way, before I became a pastor. I've been pastoring for 12 years, but I've been counseling as early as my 20s, over 20 years back. And somehow, I knew that God wanted me to do counseling. Just to put it this way, when I saw older people, I was just a Bible college graduate. When I saw older people coming to my yard, come asking to help their marriage, and I said, then who sent you here, sir? Then say, your brother, my biological brother. He said, we can't talk to you. Why am I saying all of that? For us to understand that over the years, as I've been counseling people, and I've been helping people, some have been helped and some have not been helped. I'm just saying that. I have noticed that the third point I'm going to talk about is one of the most neglected areas by fathers. Nurture and care. I'm going to put it this way, by some fathers. Let me get to the verses, and then I'll tell you what I'm talking about, because some will let it come clear in a moment. Third thing, the good father should nurture and care for his children. Remember, we're not going to talk about money here. We know that protection and provisions and, you know, providing financially is good. But that's why I said that many men say, me pay for your schooling. You're starving? No, you're not starving. And me, I deal with them. So I'm a good father. But you see, some fathers focus on the financial and not the emotional. I'm getting there, but I have to share this with you. I am not saying that this is what happened in the father's heart, but I found it strange. A few days ago, I was watching television Jamaica, and they have been promoting different aspects of fathers, and this particular father was named and said that he was a good father. And the children were talking about him being a good father, and the wife was talking about him being a good father, the church was talking about him being a good father. He has about 3 children, and one of them is handicapped. But all the accolades were going out, and I could not help but notice this one thing that made me wonder. I'm not judging the man, but I found it a little strange. Here's what happened. So they were saying, "Daddy, we love you." And they then hugged him. And I want you to pretend for a moment that I am being hugged by my children as I reenact how the father reacted. You're watching too, sister. He did like this. Pretend that I'm being hugged, you know. He did like this. And if I'm smiling, I don't know, serious. I said to myself, am I judging this man too much, or is it that this man is used to affection? Can I just put it this way? I have to take off my glasses again. Listen to me. Some of the man is used to affection, you know. So that even when it is being given to uno don't even know what to do with it. When your children hug you, hug them back. When your children say, I love you, love them back. Tell them that you love them too. When your children show affection, show it back. It's supposed to be glad for the hug. My take on this is that they weren't throwing him so that him couldn't even smile. And I say, I'm not judging the man, but I just simply found it strange. But yet they say he's a good father. Them say he's the greatest. But can I put it this way? Sometimes the greatest still lacks some of the greatest. Somebody said, the woman, they shake them head hard. Why did I preface myself by saying I've been a counselor for 20 odd years? And I'm telling you, men, that some of our Jamaican men lack this idea of care and nurture. And I pray to God that no man in this auditorium is like that. I hope you're loving your children, and I can't leave out the wife. I hope you're loving your wife. You see somebody's wife, thank you, Jesus, thank you. Talk it, Pastor. Me no want to talk to Lord, make him look bad. Yet, you don't think me no know what going on. And you want to watch somebody man them face. Me no like read people's expression, you know, it's bad. However, one or two men almost look like me, like them. I'm not their favorite person anymore. Me used to respect him, you know, but boy. I'm just joking. But what I'm saying is this. It's you need to understand this if you haven't understood it yet. Nurture and care to children. It is like their minerals, their vitamins and their minerals of love. Am I making sense? So if you don't nurture and care for them, they are going to be starving of that emotional affection as well as that kind of affirmation that is needed to them. And they are going to be longing for it. And there are other people who will fill that gap. And I'll start with mommy. Mommy will fill that gap. And then if you're not careful, you wonder why they gravitate to mommy more than you. Then also, I was going to say man, but it's both ways. Other people will also fill that gap on the outside. You don't want to send your daughters or your sons to be gravitating and grasping and gambling their emotions for other people's affection. Give them that kind of love. And I know I haven't introduced scripture, so yes, let's get there. We're going to look at 2 passages and then I'll close. Ephesians chapter 6, thankfully it's just one verse, but it's a power-packed verse. And then 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. So go to Ephesians chapter 6. Yes, you know it very well. What am I talking about? The good father should nurture and care for his children. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4. It says, "And ye fathers," "provoke not your children to wrath." Do not provoke your children to anger. Because sometimes some fathers can provoke their children, you know. And some fathers are saying, "But dear pastor, how is that even possible?" I think I might have given you this story already. Maybe it was on a night service, but I'll give it to you again. I've often talked about my father in a way that I want to still honor him as a father. But I can tell you that without any apology, that the father we had lacked the emotion. So I know, in other words, I know exactly how that feels. We had a still have him. We have a father who was a great provider and a great protector. We never lacked anything financially. We never lacked. He provided, but he was not affection. If I should rate his affection between 1 and 10, 10 being the highest and 0 being the lowest, 1 being the lowest, I would say to you that my father was like a 2. And I don't want to disrespect him, but it's true. Every member of my family, including my mother, could tell you that. He was strong on provisions and protection, but low on affection and coming to the idea of provoking us unto wrath. My father was this kind of person. And I'm coming down. Pretend that Orville here is my father. And the remote is right beside my daddy, Orville. I am outside doing the chores he sent me to do, raking up the leaf when I'm sending for door. I bawl out my name as a little boy. Duane! Yes, daddy. Come here, man, come here. When I came into the house, sweaty and everything, yes, daddy, pass the remote for me. But because I'm afraid of him, what I do? I take it up and I give him. But in my heart, I say, what kind of man this I take advantage? You can't take the remote for yourself. A whole heap of stuff I say to him, but he now come out. Because I'm afraid of the man. I'm going to talk some things, you know. All three of us as children grew up afraid of our father because he was very stern and aggressive. Good provider, good protector, but no affection. So it was the, what is show name? The Sound of Music. You know that over 3 hours show there? The Von Trapp family? Yes, daddy. This is how we were. Why am I sharing that personal information for you to understand? Check your children, fathers, and make sure they're not afraid of you. Because I can tell you something. If them grow up afraid of you, you might be saying, well, me achieve my goal. Me want them afraid of me, my man. You will watch and see as soon as them become adult how fast they left the house. More quicker than you want them to. Them not stay in a prison. They don't want no general or no army official to lead them. They want a loving father. So I'm saying, men, be affectionate to your children, be loving to your children. Don't be afraid to balance this idea of discipline and love. Discipline them and then be able to love them and hug them. So that they don't see as a disciplinarian. The hand that backs you, the hand that beats you. That's all some people know. So, Ephesians 6 verse 4 says, do not provoke your children to wrath. Can I just say this? I want to balance a thing. My brother and I, and even my sister, but my brother and I as males, we grew up and we saw those things with our father. And as we became adults, we sat down and we talked through it and we say, you know what? If we were ever to have wives or children, we're not going to treat our spouses and our children that way. We're not going to let them be afraid of us. We should show affections to our spouses and affections to our children. We made that pact. In other words, we decided, why am I saying all this? We decided to break that cycle because from what I have studied in culture, some men, their fathers treat them this way, they grow up and treat their children and spouses that way. Not you, some. So we were, can I say it, smart young men. We looked at society and we learned a lot of lessons from them. We looked in family and we learned a lot of lessons from them. And we said to ourselves, we are not going to come up and do the same thing. Our children must not be afraid of us. Our spouses must not be afraid of us. The last thing they must be saying, boy, this man, you give me too much affection. It better you cry for too much than too little. All right? So I tell you, we made that pact. And I want some of you as children to make that pact. Even if your father is not giving you affection, to grow up and give your children and your wife affection in the time to come. But men, that you are required to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. You are required to bring them up, to grow your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. What do those two terms mean, nurture and admonition? Nurture means a lot of things. It is a comprehensive word. So listen up, men. When the Bible tells you to nurture your children or bring them up in the nurture, and by the way, sometimes we miss this, so I'm going to say it before I miss saying it. Sometimes we focus on the word nurture and admonition and forget the phrase that follows. The nurture and admonition of the... Thank you. Can I put it this way? Some men just stop at nurture and admonition and find them one definition to nurture and admonition. He wants you to nurture them in the Lord, by the Lord, through the Lord, of the Lord. He wants you to admonish them in the way of the Lord. Not your own way, not psychology's way, not even the opinions of books. In God's way. Thank you, sister. So what does the nurture and admonition of the Lord look like? The word nurture is comprehensive, and it means in the tutorage, education, training, disciplinary correction, and instruction. Disciplinary correction. So you mustn't be afraid to discipline them when them go wrong. But you must be educating them and training them, and you must be instructing them. But then admonition here means to call to attention, to call something to the attention of the persons. Admonition also means it means a mild rebuke or a warning. In other words, Ephesians 6 verse 4 is saying, fathers, that you must bring up your children with Christian training and instruction. With Christian training and instruction. Then I'm going to skip to 1 Thessalonians 2. And then I'm going to say some more about affections. Yes, we want some men to leave here changed today. 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 11. Paul was talking to the church at Thessalonica, and he was saying that we have given you love and care. And then he was going to then say, as a father doth, you know, give that kind of care. So he says, as you know how we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you as a father doth his children. You know what is interesting? Because some of you might be saying, Pastor, what? That verse doesn't even carry no weight. I want you to understand it carries a lot of weight. You need to understand when Paul says this, that we have exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you as a father doth his children. It is making an assertion, not an assumption. It is making an assertion that a father does these things, or that a father should be doing these things. And what are they? To charge them, to comfort them, and to exhort them. To comfort means to, this is where I'm going to talk about affections again. To comfort, there, the Greek word that is used means to relate closely to. To encourage, to relate closely to. Fathers, if you have not done so yet, it is time to get up and personal with your children. It is time for them to see the softer side of daddy. Yes, they feel safe in your protective arms, but is it just the soldier arms you are giving them? Is it just that kind of, you know, rough and tough? Remember we sang a song, Brother Prout, that's Colin Prout, you know, a father whose love is tough and gentle. You know, the idea is it's a balance. And so it's time for men to get up close and personal with their children, their sons and their daughters, and to sit down and talk to them and to show them the care, the nurture, the affections that is needed. The word comfort also means to encourage, you know. It is not to batter bruise them and to, you know, batter bruise them with words too, because sometimes there are some fathers who will, you know, use the hand or whatever else, weapons or whatever else. But then the idea is that sometimes even with the words, It is to encourage them. We're not talking about godly discipline. You know what godly discipline looks like. But it's the idea that, listen, want my son, let me talk to you today. What's going on? Want my daughter, let me talk to you. Let them see that other side of you. There are some of us, and I include myself, who have grown up and we're adults now, and we never got to see the other side of our fathers. May I make a statement? Possibly because some of them never even... No, it might sound weird. Sister Bev, why are you reading out my mind, sir? Some of them now have that side there. And I'm not saying that it cannot be brought out. But some of you men grow tough, and you grow rough, and you don't remember what it was like when you are roughed up. And you decided that you are going to still do the same cycle. I'm saying you have to break the cycle, men, and to understand that there's a balance. I've said this to parents, you know, I said it in a loving way. I've said this to parents that, and I'm going to say it, and it was to mothers and fathers. If you are not prepared to give your children nurture and love and care, and even financial provision to provide for them, you should not be having any. I make no apologies for that. If you are not prepared to love them, care for them, nurture them, provide for them, don't have any. I'm serious. Here's why. You are the parent, they are the children. A child, 2 months, 3 months, grows up. That's what they need. You expect them to give it to you? No, you must give it to them. Wanna look like, wanna beg some, you know? I will repeat, Deacon Everard Proud, it's a great responsibility. So know what you're getting into before you become a parent. If you know you can't provide, in other words, I want you to leave change, you know. If you know, Pastor, you don't know me grew up rough and tough, me can't show them affection like that. Me can't, you're already in it. Stop saying you can't and do it. You took on the responsibility to be a father. That's what children need more. You provide all of the wealth you want, all the school fee paid for, all the money, all of the groceries you want, and you don't give them that. Watch and see what happens. Boy. I can look at some people's faces and some hurting, some disappointed, while some glad that them have a father like that. While some men are saying, boy, Pastor, true, but it's going to be hard for me. May I encourage you to think about the child or the children then. If you find it hard to show them nurture and care, think about them and to say, look at this precious child that I have, and this precious child is expecting precious affection from me. Think about them. You cannot expect your children to lead in the affection department. It is you who are to teach them affections. Amen? So, you thought I forgot a word. Exhort, we understand what that means, but charge here. That's an interesting word. We're still on verse 11, and he says, charge. He expects fathers to charge their children. This is an interesting word. It's not the same as some of the others you have seen. This word charge here means testifying. It means to plead on the behalf of, to give a good report of, and to cheer your children on. You are to be their cheerleaders. Oh, Lord. You know, 125 already? Oh, my Lord. You have been so patient. I'm going to wrap up. But let me just say this. And I think men needed to hear this. So thank you for your patience. I want to say this and close. Too many fathers have not been there for their children. They have allowed the mothers, not all of the fathers, you know, but some fathers have allowed the mothers to be the cheerleaders, to be there for their graduation. The mother is there. To be there for the parent-teacher meeting, the mother is there. To be there for other things, the mother is there. And I'm saying that you have to be careful, fathers, that you're not your child's cheerleader. You need to be their cheerleader. You need to be testifying on their behalf and pleading on their behalf and give a good report of. Can I count on some men to change if you were struggling here? To be the good father? Let me remind you what the good father looks like. A good father should have a positive influence on his children. A good father should give good guidance to his children. And a good father should nurture and care for his children. Do not be like the other fathers who are mediocre and never provided these things because they use the culture card. Me never grow so. You can do this. You have not been grown like that, or you can grow out of that and grow into this. Let us pray. Help our fathers. Help our fathers. Some of them here have been great fathers, and they actually have been doing all of these things, and we praise God for them. We want to encourage them to continue and to be that kind of father. God, I pray for them that they will keep on that line, that path of righteousness, to do what is right for the children, to do what is right for their spouse. Lord, then I pray for the fathers, some fathers who lack these things. They're not giving the good guidance like they should, and they know it. Some fathers are not a spiritual influence on their children, and they know it. And then some are not showing enough affections, nurture, and care to their children, and they know it. And their children know it. And their spouses are suffering for it as well. It makes it more difficult for the children to simply appreciate them. So Lord, I pray that our men will step up to the plate and understand what a total man really looks like. It's not just the protector, it's not just the provider, but it's the guider. It's the guide. It's the lover, the loving father, and the loving husband. It is the total package. And yes, a lot has been entrusted on them. But Lord, help them to understand, one way or the other, whether they purposefully took it on or it happened by accident, they are fathers now. Help them to not feel beaten and bruised right now, but to just look into themselves and to say, I lack these things, but I want to be a better father. Help them to even right now be planning a heart-to-heart with their family, to sit them down and to say, son, have I been doing these things? Son, have I really, you know, neglected you? Daughter, have I neglected you? Help them to ask the hard questions and to simply give their children opportunity to speak. Because then and only then will some of them even know what they're giving. And even their wives to speak as well. And in the name of Jesus Christ, I only ask that better families will emerge from today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.